Hello, I'm Perry Farrell. You're watching Life Minute TV with Joanne Butler.
He's the famous frontman of the bands Jane's Addiction and Porno for Pyros, the mastermind behind the Lollapalooza Festival. Others just refer to him as the godfather of alternative rock. This legend has recently come out with a 35-year retrospective of his life, music, and art that looks into his world outside of the works of Jane's and Porno for Pyros. 68 tracks worth of his alt-rock rarities and artistic explorations from his first band, Psycom, in the early 80s, all the way to his most recent, Kind Heaven, on which he collabs with his wife, Eddie Lau Farrell. This is a Life Minute with Perry Farrell.
As the pandemic started, I also got a new management team that proposed an idea to me, and it was to kind of organize all my art, all my pictures, all my music. I had music that was blown to all four corners of the earth, you know? And so they put together all my solo stuff. I have memoirs in a box set of records. So I've got 9 records, one of them which is a hologram record, like real vinyl. And as it spins, the hologram moves, and it's trippy. I worked with this artist by the name of Zoltar. He's from London, and incredible art for the box set. So I thought, yeah, it's time to do it. I mean, I always thought to write my memoirs at 60, and I'm now turning 62. I'm right there. It's time. I've got some good stories to share. I love where I'm at right now. I started 35 to 40 years ago putting out my own music. I put my first record out for like $500, and I would try to distribute it out of the back of my car, you know. This is when record stores were all around, and the good ones in LA, the underground ones, I would go and just come in with a record. I go, would you like to buy my records? And the guy would say, well, look, I'm not going to give you anything for them, but you're welcome to put them in the bin under P, you know. So that's how I started. But the trip about it is, these days I'm back to that. So I now have a team that we put out our own records. That's the box set. It's the first one. It's on Last Man Records, but I own the publishing, and if it's going to succeed, it's all on me. And I can put out music anytime I want. I don't have to wait a year. I don't have to make it an album. I don't have to kiss anybody's ass if the record company doesn't love music. I find it interesting when I listen to the early recordings of Psycom. So the songs were very heavy, and you know, of course there are a lot of them about drugs and sex and partying, but also one of the tracks that I'm gonna start performing again is a song called Hokahe. I thought it meant it's a fine day to die. And I thought it was a cry that the Native Americans would say just before they went into war. But I have come to find out it really means, let's go, man. So I was always kind of siding with the indigenous people, the underdog, disenfranchised, and the poor. The trick in life, can I tell you the trick in life? You work hard to amass a fortune, and you start to help people, help the world with that fortune, because you are fortunate, you know, by the grace of God. So that's how I like to look at it.
What was your childhood like growing up? Did you always know you wanted to be in music?
My sister pretty much taught me how to be a man, how to be a human. And my brother was a wild one. He was an outlaw biker. And so he taught me how to live out, I don't want to say outside the law, but live free, put it that way. When I was a little boy, I sang nonstop. I go back to my brother and sister. They were mad for music. My brother roommated with Jimi Hendrix for a time. my sister ended up to marry the bass player for Richie Havens. So we all loved music so much in the house. We had that stack of 45s, you know, back in those days, and we'd play records on the front porch in Queens, in Flushing, and people would walk by, and, you know, that's when the great British invasion happened. So the Beatles, you know, affected me at the age of, you know, five. I had Beatle boots. I had real Beatle boots. As I got older, my family broke up, and I ended up living with my father's second wife, who I don't think she wanted me to even live, but she definitely didn't like me making music. She'd always tell me, shut up. And I would go around the house whistling and singing all day, and she'd say, shut up. So when I came out to California, I had no intentions of being a musician, but I loved music. Like, you know, I followed music the way any passionate music lover would, going through their teens, you know, like music was everything to me. I didn't think I wanted to actually be a musician. I just loved it. And when I got out to California, punk rock, I was living in here in LA, and you'll find this funny, but I was living with a man who wanted me to be an actor. So he was managing me. So I took acting lessons. So I would go and take these classes and do method acting, but then they'd send me out for a toothpaste commercial, you know? And I quickly learned, like, I don't wanna sell no damn toothpaste. I wanna write about wild stories and, you know, about life. So I dropped the course, and I moved out, and the rest is history. Joy Division was a major influence, The Doors, The Germs, you know, then of course in the back, I had in my back pocket, you know, Hendrix, The Stones, The Beatles, Velvet. This goes on, you know, we could talk for days and days and weeks and weeks and years and years.
I want to know, did your stepmom see you become famous? She's proud of you?
No, never. No, she wasn't, no, we were not on the same team. It's a long story, but it's in the memoirs.
What about the guys from James? Do you still hang out?
Well, I just got some tracks this morning from Stephen Perkins asking me if I'd sing on some drum tracks that he just laid out. So yeah, we are in touch with each other and, you know, looking into the future and see where we can get in there again and rock out. Jane's Addiction had been out on the road for years, and I wanted to give it a break. So I told everybody this, you know, this is gonna be the last tour, and I don't know what I'm gonna do after that, but that's it. That, you know what I mean? Like, I don't know, but I'm officially not in anybody's band. William Morris said to me, well, you know, you can do anything you want in this last tour. I said, anything? Yeah, man, I mean, you got, you know, you're there. So I just started giving them a list of requests. I want to have a gallery, an art gallery, and I want hot air balloons, you know, vegetarian tacos, the size of an elephant's trunk. So that was very successful, but unexpected that William Morris came back to me and said, all right, the Chili Peppers said they will, you know, do the next one. And I slowed him down, and I went, what one are you talking about? The next Lolla, you got to do it. Okay, I'm in. That's how it worked. That's the evolution. Now we're coming up to the moment where we have to decide whether we're going to do Lollapalooza this coming August. And I'm trying to encourage people, get vaccinated.
Make sure to get vaccinated as soon as you can,
so that we can see each other at Lollapalooza again this summer. We all take care. Social distance, keep doing that. Keep wearing masks. Vaccinate. I mean, if President Biden says July 4th is his timeline, mine's a first weekend of August. That's when Lala is always.
Yeah. Fingers crossed.
Yeah.
What's it all about for you? What inspires you? What propels you as an artist?
Well, life. Life is just so amazing. I've never stopped loving living. And so every aspect of life is a potential song. Love, falling in love, having a wild time, taking a trip, you know, with your friends to the Grand Canyon. And then you can have negative, you can have kind of political rebuttals of things that are going down. And there's so many things that are going down right now. It's easy to get negative and write extremely powerful but aggressive songs. But I don't like to dwell too much on it. I prefer to, as I say, come up with solutions.
Tell us about your wife. You've been together for so long.
We're coming up on our 20th. Good marriage is compromise. Remember your vow. You know, we're constantly propping each other up. And therefore, we're always attractive to each other. We're always there for each other.
Yeah. You have a great sense of style. You always have. Where did that come from?
Well, my mom used to love to dress. My sister used to love to play dress up using me as the mannequin or as the doll. But sometimes she dressed me up as a woman. So that's where I got my, like, hey, I don't look bad as a woman. Yeah, this beret might work tonight, you know? But as you get older as a man, start to try to look less like a woman, because older guys don't look great in dresses. So I try to look more butch. How am I doing? I'm pretty butch today, right?
You look good. You always look good. What's your secret?
Starting with mentally, I always try to stay in a good mood. I always try to stay creative and kind and loving, and that'll make you beautiful. Honestly, there's so much work to do on the earth. I've started a charity, and I'm going to be looking for hot spots around the world. Like as an example, that plastic island in the middle of the ocean. Let's get rid of that thing and let's figure out what to do with plastic. So, I mean, you know, work never ends when you're a mensch.
To hear more of this interview, visit our podcast, Life Minute TV, on iTunes and all streaming podcast platforms.